check. We're back. Bonnie.
Yes sir.
Umedish.
Nimeshiba.
Na unajua energy yako ilikuwa inaenda down bana.
Asante sana.
I was not sure if it was.
Me just want to drink the rest here to drink in here. Nipatie tu drink one hata ukisitua hapa.
Uliza bien.
Mbona mnaninyima? Ama bien kwa fanya. Acha. Acha. Una drink. Uh-huh. Guys, for the sake of those who are asking, I'm having coffee, but you can spike it.
We'll spike it later. Sitaki ati wanze kulala kwa show. So anyway, Boni, first and foremost, thank you so much for your journey.
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing it very openly. Hey, even your own son is learning about you here.
Really?
But I want us to continue with the story. The story was getting a bit serious in terms of conversation. Yeah. So we had gotten to post-election violence, the kind of stuff that you were seeing. But now, where I think we left it off was the handshake.
True, but I want to take a step back a bit.
Kuna shida, tuende.
So, you have an election on 27th December 2007.
Mm.
So it's between Raila Odinga and Mwai Kibaki. So we go to the polls and there's a lot of ethnic tension because these guys were 40 against one, 41 against one. There's a lot of political debt, same thing they do right now.
Mm.
So when you go to the polls, there's a dispute about what happened to the election. So Raila Odinga says his victory was stolen. Then Kibaki says I've won. So Kibaki is sworn in at night, kwa giza.
Mm. Yeah. Form 16A.
Yes, akakuwa sworn in.
Mm.
He becomes president. And then there's violence in the country. The country is burning. But while the country is burning, there's the place where it doesn't burn. So middle class, upper class Kenyans, I would go to Kile and kids are cycling on the roads. Then I go back on this other side, there are IDPs and kids dying outside the Moi Air Force Base. Because some people ran to the Air Force, wakakawa hapo inji, wakasema tu hapa tu, we are safe.
Mm. Guys ran even from Kibera to Jammu.
Yes,
Jammu showground.
Showground. Mm. People in the showground. Like people just displaced across this country. And because I remember going to Eldoret to cover the story and my driver was Kigen. And Kigen was a Kale, but his wife was Kikuyu. And he said some boys came, wanted to come and burn his house and kick his wife out. He said, I dare you because I know all your fathers. But you see, there was that ethnic violence in this country. And you never talk about those things because in a span of 2 months, over 1,000 people were killed. Over 500,000 were displaced. People lost their property. They lost their land. They lost everything.
Mm.
Women were raped. Boys were sodomized. People were forced to be circumcised. There was so much violence in this country. But we never talk about it.
Mm.
So I was on the front line of covering that violence. I saw not most of the things. I saw some of the things that actually happened. I saw guys being hacked like this. I saw guys who had been shot like this. I met women who had been raped. I found dead bodies in the streets. I saw babies dying in the IDP camps. I was there. I was just documenting. And I was like a zombie because you document, you go home, you have nightmares. You come up in the morning, then you go back again for 2 months.
Mm.
I was seeing that every single day.
And there's also what you said, how you take it to the newsroom. So what we are seeing is the sanitized.
So the images were sanitized. So the violence was very, very ugly. And that's why we did a book called Kenya Burning later on. But it was very ugly. But the editors, in their wisdom, which was wise, said that we can't share these pictures. But now, as we move on, we talk about post-election violence and what happened after, is that when Kenya went to the ICC, International Criminal Court,
yes,
the guys who were accused paid media houses to scrub all the pictures, all the videos, to avoid those being used as evidence in the ICC.
What?
So, if you go online today and search for post-election violence footage and the killings, you can't find anything. It's scrubbed. They scrubbed that. They scrubbed even, you know, like normally when you watch a news item, it's a minute or two.
Yes.
But someone shot like for 6-7 hours.
Yes, exactly. Like, the footage. The
footage.
It's only CT where we give everything.
Yeah, they scrubbed.
So even if I go to the media houses, they don't have the archives. You see, for example, a lot of people, let me even explain what you're trying to say. So people can shoot an interview, but they only put 45 minutes of that interview.
True.
And that interview was 3 hours long.
Or a whole day.
Exactly, or a whole day.
Yes.
So that other excess footage was even deleted.
Deleted. And even the news clips online were deleted. So when they, and this is a story we can talk about, move on, we come to when I left journalism, is that when the guys were accused of crimes against humanity realized that video footage and photos could be used as evidence against them, they scrubbed the internet. So one of the guys was very vocal, and we can come back to that. We'll come back to the ICC, because the ICC and what really happened. But now, so these 2 months, I've covered the violence. And when I'm covering the violence, I have a new wedding date. So I plan to get married on March 8th of 2008. So the violence happens from December, late December, to when February 28th, Kibaki and Raila shake hands, and they form the coalition government the following week. And so March 8th, I got married to the love of my life. So, Ndoyu, and you know, so when I talk to my wife, I'm the first poor person she ever met. I'm serious. So my wife grew up on a very sheltered middle class life. She was living in Buru, and Buru was Buru. And then they moved to another place I won't name. I don't want to be called dynasty. It's not my property. but so my wife has never met a poor person like me. The stories I tell my wife, even to date, they think it's a movie. When I tell my wife, I even miss to tell you a story. So when my mother died and I was living in this plot, where I was paying 600 shillings rent, we had two toilets, upstairs moja, chini moja. So one time I come, nimekazwa na mavi. I come and try, I want to go to shit. They had locked the door. Nikavunja. Nikaekelewati nime malicious damage. The landlord wanted 5,000 shillings. I was arrested and thrown to industry area.
What?
Yes, industry area prison when I was 18. So the whole idea.
Kwa sababu ya?
Ati nimevunja cho.
Babu, you needed to go.
To go. Nakwambia, mimi liko na grow. I grew up, you know, the whole idea, you know, like some of the guys when you're growing up, me, I grew up seeing people's shit, because you're growing up in a place where it's a toilet, but there's no flush or anything. So everyone who comes to shit, you see what they are chat. Kama walikula, walikahara, when you can get to kwa cho, let's say, hey, you pile up to hivi. Then kuna kuja nafanya na kakitu kabobo hivi, unafungua. Wah, inaenda. That is how I grew up. And then in approved school, because of the way I was being bullied, in approved school, I used to be given toilet duties. Yeah. So I'm the one when guys shit, I was the one going to wash toilets. So that's the reason why I can't take shit from anybody. Because I took shit all my life, then I was supposed to eat shit. And now I can't take shit from nobody. Because actually, and I can't stand dirty toilets. Like when I was running an institution, Power 254, I couldn't stand dirty toilets because I used to be a toilet cleaner. Me, I'm the guy. When I go to a club or the airport, me, I tip toilet cleaners. The guys who tip in the toilet, the guys who clean the toilets, me, I carry money. When I'm traveling the airport, when I'm looking at a club, even if I'm at a show, I'm a jam, I'm at my malls. I'm going to go to the airport and I'm going to go to the Because I remember I was a toilet cleaner. I was forced to clean toilets in a approved school. I lived in a plot where the toilets were just. Aye, but where were we? So I get married. So getting married, so I'm coming here from this story of where I'm an amazing photographer, I work for the Standard. My wedding day, ulikuwa na these celebrities came to my wedding. I remember the day before my wedding, I love Harry Kimani and the song Higher. So Harry Kimani was supposed to come and sing at our wedding. So the previous day, we find Harry Kimani. We pay money and we pay a minder for Harry Kimani. He should not drink. We paid for someone not to drink. So Harry Kimani comes. We said, if you come drunk, you're not going to perform. So sings for my wife going down the aisle. And then, kwenda photo shoot kurudi, jawasha piga tei. So we have a beautiful wedding. I had outriders on my wedding. Limousine. Wajua ash. Limousine. Likonga socialite wedding, my friend. That's 2008, so I get married. And I get married, go for the honeymoon. So on my wedding day, my wife makes fun of me. And you can see that I cried. Because I'd seen so much. And then here was this beautiful moment. So we got married.
Yeah, that's deep.
Yeah.
So for you, that was a breather. Your wife was like her walking down and about to spend the rest of her life with you.
Yes, yes, man. Alinioa juu ya shida. You know, a joke with I say, my wife married me out of pity. Alinirumia. Akasema huyu jamaa. Nikosa kuwa huyu ndio ndaoa. Eh, kuna wewe wanaume unasema tulipendwa. Mimi sikupendana, mimi nilipendwa. Sasa ni urumi wako mjamaa, my friend.
Okay, wait, let's go back.
Nikapeleke uptown.
She's done well. Amenishangaza.
So I get married, flashy wedding, nice wedding. We moving together. But now, this is now where what I saw during post-election violence comes back to haunt me.
Mm.
So I go and leave because I've gotten married. I come back to the newsroom. Now I'm an employee of Standard. I have a studio which I'm running where all the celebrities come for pictures. And then I'm assigned to cover politicians. And now this is bothering me because one of the things about this country, we like moving very fast and forgetting. Mm-hmm. We move on very fast.
Mm.
So this country...
Not even forgetting, barring.
We bury or we pretend it doesn't exist or it doesn't happen. So the violence, like the physical violence, has ended. But the effects of the violence was everywhere. As you said, ASK showground, in Nakuru
Karura, showground grounds, Karura Chapel.
Doret, Kiambua, Polari, like Madare. Like there were IDPs everywhere in this country.
Yep.
There were families that were looking for their loved ones. So this country has open, visible billboards of the effects of the violence. Like you can see, and I'm talking about billboards, I'm talking about physical spaces where there were thousands of people living in internally displaced camps, like refugees in their own country. That's what is going on. However, our politicians had forgotten. Now it was Raila Odinga and Mwai Kibaki forming the Grand Coalition or the Grand Theft Coalition because this looted a lot, the Grand Looting Coalition. So they formed this national government of national unity. And so my job as a photographer now is to continue with my work. I continue being assigned to go and cover Raila Odinga. I'm assigned to cover Kibaki. I'm assigned to cover these people that I will not name that are very useless. So I'm just saying, and every time I go out, I get hurt. Every time I go out, I get hurt. Every time I go out, I get upset. Like, these people, have they forgotten? Because when you cover politicians, you go to these very expensive hotels, and then they have very expensive cars. But I could see what I'd seen.
Mm.
And then, because I'm still covering, there'll be a story that a baby died in an ADP camp, you're sent. And then you see the dead because of pneumonia, because it's very cold.
But the guys who
they were fighting for, or the reason why they became victims, have forgotten them. So me, I'm very restless in the newsroom. Very restless. Very restless. So, nikavumilia, I ran my studio. I'm actually never at work. I'm still in my studio just wondering, what can I do? Then around September 2018, there's a sensation in the world. There's a man making waves, man. He's young, he's black, he's charismatic. He's doing rallies and saying, oh, change you can believe in, oh, hope, all these things. And I'm reading him in the papers. I'm like, dude, this guy's changing the world, man. And then they say he was a community organizer. That's the one that caught me. Community organizer running for president. So I said, wow, I need to know how I can cover these elections. So I go to my boss and say, I want to cover the US elections. They're like, no, you're crazy, you can't. I said, I want to cover the US elections. I said, but we don't have a budget. I said, if I get money, will you allow me to go and cover the US elections? And they said, yes, go get money. So I go to a bank in this country, I walk in, and I give them my pay slip. And they give me 700,000 shillings. So I use the 700,000 shillings to part in the business, the photo studio, and then take part of that money to go to the US to cover the US election. So I spend about 300,000 shillings to cover the US elections. Just say to go to the US. And when I go to the US, I land in Philadelphia.
Yeah, our story for days.
I land in Philadelphia. It's a black neighborhood. And then you see my gangster two guys just walking like this. Yeah, poor people. I stay with this family, Chris Omalwa. God bless him. He's in a very good, nice family. But when I land in the US, there's no Obama, man. It's the last 3 days of the elections. So Obama is running for president of the United States. So he's flying one city to another city to another city.
Yep.
So I go to the US to cover the US elections, but I end up watching Obama on TV. I never saw him anywhere.
What?
So I stayed there for 2 weeks. Obama is elected. The world is elated.
You didn't even go for the inauguration?
Dude, it was in Chicago.
It was Chicago, Washington.
No, inauguration was in January.
Oh, yes, 20th. You're right.
But the victory speech was in Chicago, Hyde Park.
Okay, uh-huh.
But I was in Philadelphia. That night was actually in Jersey City. So it's another... And then I went there with the shoestring budget.
Mm.
You know, when you talk about 300,000 shillings, once you buy the ticket,
yeah.
150 is gone. When you have 150 and you land in the US, 10,000 is $100, man.
Yep.
So when you have a cup of coffee, $5, $10. Do you know, it's just a shame that when I was in the US, because I was being hosted by this lovely family, and I really wanted to eat a burger, and I couldn't afford. I couldn't buy a burger for everyone in that house.
Mm.
So I went with Peter Opondo. I was with Peter Opondo in the US, then working for KTN. And so I went to eat a burger, and then our host found us there.
The embarrassment.
Because you couldn't buy for everyone in that house. Because there are many people and you couldn't afford.
Yeah.
I know Chris Omalwa will watch this and laugh. But he's a very kind man. He's still in the US. He's in Delaware. An amazing guy who hosted me for the first time when I went to the US. So I see how Obama did it. The community organizing and all that. So I come back home in November after the US elections. And I'm grappling with quitting my job. Because one, I don't cover politicians anymore.
Mm.
I can't stand them. Because every time I see them, I want to vomit. And I'm like, what do I do? So there's a guy called Maina Mwirore. He was one of the editors. Then he was a chief sub-editor. He called me and said, Bonfas, come here. So I&M building has it's a very tall building.
Yep.
He goes on the 8th floor. He said, you see those guys walking around there? Because my fear was, I'm quitting my job, I'm newly married, and I have this business that is not really, really picking up.
Yeah.
So when I'm already called me to the floor, and I'm like, no, chini. And I'm like, no, I say, what? Those guys don't work at the standard. Those guys, you see them walking. And they don't sleep hungry. Do they look hungry to you? It's okay, you can go.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
That's good that he told you that.
Yeah, can I be you don't have to worry about it. There's another boss was up there. Well, I said, if you guys can't, because I was very good. I wanted to be promoted now to move from being that guy, photographer, going out there to meet with politicians to a desk job where I manage other people. Because I didn't want to go and hang out with politicians. I didn't want to see any politicians. But I was hurting from what I saw. So I put in my letter to resign, and I resigned that December. I leave a comfortable salary of 90,000. And a press card, and with this 90K, I used to do other side jobs, you know.
Mm, mm.
So I quit my job, and I'm out here.